Hi friends, today's topic is mass spectrometry and its applications in characterization of samples. This is the utmost important topic in most of the research and in most of the examinations point of view. So, and after watching these videos, if you like my channel, please like them, subscribe them, and if you want any notes, you can text me on my email ID. And personally, if you have any doubts, you can text me on my WhatsApp number. Thank you. Let's go into the topic. What exactly the mass spectrometry tells? And do not get confused with the term spectroscopy with spectrometry. The term spectroscopy should not be used with the mass spectrometry, as mass spectrometry is the measure of M by Z value, whereas spectroscopy tells you about interaction of electromagnetic radiation with sample. So do not use the term spectroscopy in spectrometry. So mass, whenever you talk about mass, you should always pronounce it as spectrometry. Okay, now what exactly mass spectrometry is? An analytical technique for measuring the mass to charge ratio of ions in gas phase. Okay, so why the molecules or should be in the gas phase, and why, what are the different types of sources of mass spectrometry? We will see them. Okay, now mass spectrometry is our most valuable analytical tool for determining accurate molecular masses. Okay, now what is your mass of your final product can be determined by mass spectrometry. Mass spectrometry gives information of the structure of the product. It will not give exact information, but it will give an indirect information of structure of the product. Okay, and even by using this mass spectrometry techniques, you can identify the molecular weight of proteins, and indirectly you can identify the structure of proteins also. Next, now a mass spectrometer is designed in such a way that to convert the neutral molecules into a beam of positive or negative ions. So mass spectrometry, again, it is divided into two types: positive ion mass spectrometry and negative ion mass spectrometry. So always you should remember that when you are seeing any spectra, so you should not directly search for the M by Z in the spectra. Always either you should search for M by Z plus 1 or M by Z minus 1 or M by Z plus 23. These are the three most important things while you search of any mass spectrum. So why? Suppose if it is a positive ion mass spectrometry, so you will get M by Z plus 1 value. If it is a negative ion mass spectrometry, you will get M by Z minus 1 value. Suppose if it is and most of the glassware are the sources of sodium. So what happens, as well as even the silica, it contains sodium. Whenever you do column chromatography or even you add sodium sulfate, so there are so many sources of sodium. So always three M by Z values should be searched in any mass spectrum. First one is M by Z plus 1, next one is M by Z minus 1, and M by Z plus 23. Later on you will apply the general principles of mass spectrum. Now once convert the neutral molecules into a positive or negative ions, then separate the ions into mass to charge ratio. Once you separate them, now you will search for the relative abundance of each signal. So this is the fundamental information of designing of mass spectrometers. Next, now sources of sample. Where, see, mass is the detection technique which is coupled with chromatographic technique. So again you need to understand that hyphenated techniques, when you will add hyphen is to thing is when you are joining two instruments, then only you will use the word hyphen. Suppose if you see GC hyphen MS, what does it indicate? There is a hyphen where you are connecting two instruments. Why you are connecting? Because GC can separate the components, but GC cannot characterize the components. Whereas mass can characterize the components, but it cannot separate or purify the components. So we are combining both two components such that the output deformalities of one instrument is nullified by the input deformalities of the another instrument. This is the first most important in hyphenated techniques. That means GC cannot analyze the compounds, so it is coupled with MS. MS cannot purify the compounds, so it is connected with GC. That's why it is called as hyphenated analytical technique. Now GC means gas chromatography. Inlet of sample is from gas chromatographic column. Now in gas chromatography there are again two types: total ion monitoring and single ion monitoring. Suppose in the gas chromatography you have 5 peaks altogether. If you are scanning for this mass spectrum, it is called as total ion monitoring. Suppose each individual chromatography peak is analyzed, then it is called as single ion monitoring. Now next one is LC-MS techniques. What do you mean by LC-MS? LC-MS is, again, LC can purify and separate components, but it cannot analyze the what component in terms of mass, so it is coupled with again a mass spectrometer. Now inlet of sample from HPLC, that is high performance liquid chromatography, or UPLC, ultra pressure liquid chromatography, or FPLC, flash protein liquid chromatography, or flash chromatography. So that means these types are the inlet for the source of mass spectrum. Now ICP-MS is also called as inductive coupled plasma mass spectrometer, where you identify the mass of components purified from the plasma source. So this is the fundamental information from where the sources of sample is for the mass analysis. Next, this is the basic instrumentation in mass spectrometer. So this is the inlet. Suppose GC is coupled, directly the gas will be coming here. Suppose if a LC is connected, so again the most of the solvent should be removed and only the solvent vaporized and nebulized is passed into the space, where again here the sample is bombarded with electron. Now once the sample is bombarded with electron, the fast moving electron hits the neutral molecule, thereby taking one electron from the molecule and creating a positive charged cation. And now this charged cation will be, in the first phase it will be static. Once the charged cation is produced, it is static because it is expressed two fields, one is both electric and magnetic field in the static region. From the static region it propels forward towards the accelerating region. In the accelerating region, the fragments experience only magnetic field, and such, that's why the cations produced propagate in the circular path based upon their mass to charge ratio. Heavy atoms are deflected too little, that's why they reach the detector fastly, whereas smaller atoms deflected are very fast, so they reach the detector slowly. This is the fundamental information. Suppose if you want to know about much of the instrumentation of mass spectrometer, you can click on the below link where I have expressed about the fundamental information of how the physics is involved in the instrumentation of mass spectrometer. Next one, ionization. What do you mean by ionization? So this electron is a which is bombarding with the molecule, thereby converting the neutral molecule into a charged cation or a radical ion. So what happens, this electron when hit the molecule, this will remove one more electron from the molecule and causing two electron deficient. One electron is removed from the molecule, as well as the incident electron will also go out, so two electrons will be the coming out. So collision of this electron with the sample causes ionization in the and resulting in the radical cations. Okay, next. Type of ionization. There are several types of ionization. Electron ionization, chemical ionization, fast atom bombardment, thermospray, matrix, MALDI, matrix assisted laser desorption ionization, electrospray ionization, atmospheric pressure chemical ionization. So our next lecture will be on types of ionization techniques. Okay, that will be in the tomorrow's lecture. So please check about the update of lectures. Next, terminology used in mass spectrometer. So these are the, for any examination point of view, these terminology is very, very important. So when you identify the fragmentation in the mass spectrometer, the peak which is always having largest intensity is your base peak, and the intensity of all the other peaks is ascent with respect to your base peak. Okay, now molecular ion peak. What is molecular ion peak? This is the MBZ value exactly equivalent to the mass of the sample which you introduced. And the next one is isotopic peaks. So this is the again peculiar and very, very important point which you need to remember. So isotopic peaks are both M plus 1 and M plus 2 peaks. So carbon C12 and C13 isotopes, hydrogen H1 and H2, that is proton and deuterium, nitrogen, again nitrogen 14 and nitrogen 15. So these three different exhibits M plus 1 peaks. Okay, this, again you need to know the which atoms contribute the M plus 1 and which atoms contributes to M plus 2. This is the fundamental in characterization of any mass spectrum. Next one, halogen, chlorine and bromine. So the isotopic abundance of chlorine is chlorine 37 and chlorine 35 is 75:25. And the isotopic abundance of bromine 69 and bromine 71 is almost all 50-50. Sulfur is the only heteroatom which exhibits both M plus 1 and M plus 2 peaks. Okay, next one, fragmentation. So already I said that in any spectrum, base peak means the peak which corresponds to highest intensity. If you check the fragmentation pattern of dopamine, the peak corresponds to 124 is having highest intensity and it is given a value of 100. So this scale of relative abundance is an arbitrary value. That means if even the intensity is up to this level, the intensity is called as 100. That means any peak which is having largest intensity is considered as an 100. It need not be that it should be 100% intense. It is an arbitrary value. Whatever the peak which is having highest intensity, it is called as a base peak, and the intensity of all the other peaks are corresponded with that peak. Such type of peaks are called as basic peaks. That means base peaks. Whereas molecular ion peak is the molecular weight of that compound exactly matches the molecular ion peak. So sometimes base peak and molecular ion peaks are equal, but it is not thumb rule that always molecular ion peak will be your base peak. So do not confuse. Base peak can be molecular ion peak, but molecular ion need not be a base peak. So this is the fundamental statement you need to remember. Okay, this is very, very important. Next one, resolution in mass. In mass spectrometry is divided into two types. One is LRMS, another one is HRMS. So LRMS corresponds to low resolution mass spectrometry, and whereas HRMS contributes to high resolution mass spectrometry. Separation with respect to only by one or more mass units. That means after the decimal value, you can expect only one or two units. Suppose if you see example C3H6O and C3H8O, so these two have a mass difference of plus 2, so that they can be easily identified by low resolution mass spectrometry. Now coming for high resolution mass spectrometry, now if you see C3H8O and C2H4O2, both these have a masses of 60. Now if you take LRMS, you cannot differentiate between these two molecules. So to distinguish between these two molecules, you require HRMS, that is high resolution mass spectrometry. So you can see up to a 4 to 5 digit resolution is possible in, by using HRMS. So the same is not possible by using LRMS. Okay, clear. Next one, isotopic peaks. Already I said you that carbon, hydrogen and nitrogen show prominent M plus 1 peak, whereas hetero atoms such as chlorine and bromine will show M plus 2 peaks. So now let us see, this M is M by Z value, that is 64. If you can see, there is an M plus 2 peak, that is 64 plus 2, 66. So the relative intensity of M and M plus 2 is 1:3. So already I told you that halogen, the relative abundance between chlorine 35 and chlorine 37 is 75:25, that means 3 times the abundance. So that's why always the M and M plus 2 peaks are 1:3 in ratio. Next one is bromine. The relative abundance of bromine 69 and bromine 71 is almost 50-50. So always the M and M plus 2 peaks are equi-intensity. Okay, this is the one most advantage in your what? Now isotopic peaks. Sulfur is the only hetero atom which shows both M plus 1 and M plus 2 peaks, because M plus 1 peaks are relatively low in intensity compared with the molecular ion peak, difficult to measure with precision. So generally the isotope peaks are not useful for accurate determination of molecular weight. Okay, fragmentation. So there are two types of fragmentation. One is soft fragmentation, another one is hard fragmentation. What do you mean by soft fragmentation? Soft fragmentation is that when a molecule is hit with an electron of lowest energy, that is 15 to 20 electron volts, only one electron is removed and you will get an M by Z value. Further, there is no fragmentation. Such type of technique is called as soft fragmentation. That means there is no fragmentation of M by Z value. Whereas hard fragmentation, once after removal of electron, there is slicing of entire molecule until and unless the lowest molecular weight compound is formed. Such type of technique is called as hard fragmentation. So again, you need to be very, very careful in studying these techniques. Next one, what is fragmentation? So now, once an electron is hitting onto the molecule, neutral molecule, it will convert into a radical cation. Now the radical cation will fragment into a positive charged cation and a neutral radical. So that may be either cation may be either A or B based upon the intensities. Next one, this is very, very important one, priority of loss of electron. As I already discussed in the earlier lecture of UV, the loss of electrons, the energy required in transition of electrons from ground state to excited state, I already said that N2 pi star transition is required lowest energy. That means, what do you understand by this terminology? So N electrons are the one which can easily transform from one state to another state, that is ground state to excited state. And always remember that these are forbidden. What do you mean by forbidden? Which is not acceptable. That N2 pi star transitions are always forbidden. So why it is forbidden? If it is not forbidden, the molecule will not stable. Similarly, if you come for mass spectrometry, these are the N electrons which are removed first. Now hard fragmentation. Hard fragmentation is what? You just take a molecule and hit with longer energy, that is around 70 electron volt, so that there is complete fragmentation of molecule. Okay, this is the fundamental information from the what fragmentation pattern. Now stability of cation. So suppose if you are fragmenting any molecule, Now you need to identify whether a carbocation is formed or a carbanion is formed. Whatever it forms, always more stable carbocation preferentially forms than the least stable carbocation. This is the fundamental information of stability of fragments from the parent ion or embedded value. Next one, rule of nitrogen. So this is the, now the we are going to discuss two rules. These two rules will give you a rough idea about your structure. So these rules are very, very important. First rule is rule of nitrogen. What is rule of nitrogen? Says that if a molecule contains zero or even number of nitrogen, always the embedded value will be even. And if a molecule contains odd number of nitrogen, always its molecule or ion will have an odd embedded value. This is also very, very important in your concept. So presence or absence of nitrogen can be easily identified by nitrogen rule. Next rule, rule of 13. So this is a very, very beautiful rule, in which what you need to do is, whatever the molecule is given to you, if you know the rough molecular weight, now divide that molecular weight by 13. What does 13 indicate? It is atomic mass number of carbon and hydrogen, total carbon and hydrogen 13. Now once you divide 13, you will get, by simple division, you will get two components. One is quotient and another one is remainder. So now you have a formula called as Q plus R by 13. Now Q is your quotient and R is your remainder. Now to get an index of deficiency in the mass spectroscopy, you have a formula called U is equal to Q minus R plus 2 by 2. Now U will tell you about number of rings and number of double bonds. Let us see with some example. Suppose I have a molecule of known molecular mass with a mass value of 94. Now applying the rule of 13, now I'll divide the 94 by 13. So now I'll get one quotient and one remainder. Remainder is always that which remains after division, that is 3, and coefficient is what with which I am multiplying the numerator to get the value of dividend. Okay, so now if you see, Q is my quotient, that is 7, R is my what, remainder. Now applying in the index of deficiency formula, Q minus R plus 2 by 2, that gives me a value of 7. 7 indicates that there are 7 carbons. Now I'll apply this 7 in the index formula, that is Q 7 R 3. 7 minus 3 plus 2 by 2. What is 7 minus 3? 4. 4 plus 2? 6. 6 by 2 is 3. So now I got an information called as U is equal to 3. Now what is U is equal to 3? Whenever U is equal to 3, it shows that 2 double bonds and 1 ring. So U, if the U value is 4 or more than 4, expect that there is a benzene in the molecule. And if U is equal to 3, that is 1 ring and 2 double bonds. Now let us see what happens. Now as expected in the structure, this is something wrong here. Actually, this should be toluene. So we expect a structure as C7H10. So now this is toluene. That is C7H10. Suppose, so not toluene exactly, it is 2 double bonds. So I cannot change that structure here. It is an cyclic alkene with one alkane. Sorry, forgive me. Now suppose if we expect the molecule with same molecular mass with heteroatom as oxygen, now deduce one carbon, that is methane, and add oxygen. Now you will get a formula of C6H6O. So now the deficiency value is 4. That means, when I already showed you, whenever there is a value of 4 or more than 4, you can expect a benzene ring and you have a OH. That's why you called as a, the molecule is a phenol. So remember that always this rule of 13 is very, very applicable for lower molecular weight compounds than the higher molecular weight compounds. Okay, thank you. Next one, fragmentation. So alkenes generally fragment at the center of the molecule. This is the first most important pattern in alkenes. And also in alkenes, most stable carbocation, that is tertiary carbocation, is more preferentially formed than secondary and than primary. Now if you see octane, there is fragmentation at the center of the molecule always, until and unless it is, and the yields is smallest molecule. You can see the largest MBZ value is 114. Now the most as the center of the molecule cleavage, and you get a fragment of 43, which is your base peak, and the lowest one will be your 14, that is only one carbon. Next one, if you see 2-4 trimethyl pentane, this is the molecule 2-4 trimethyl pentane. If you see the fragmentation pattern, the MBZ is 114. Okay, MBZ is 114. So in this all one, if you see 57, this 57 is corresponding to more stable carbocation, that is tertiary carbocation, and the next most intense will be your 43, that is what, secondary carbocation, and next one is your what, alkenyl or propargyl one. So again you need to, so not propargyl, it is allylic one. Okay, so allylic carbocation is formed. Next one, alkenes. Alkenes typically undergo cleavage ready to form resonance stable allylic cation. So again you will get allylic one. Which one is more stable? So if you see this one, this is MBZ value, and this most stable, that is allylic carbocation, is more formed. Now in the cycloalkenes, so retro diol solder. What do you mean by diol solder? Retro means fragmentation of the molecule and to get two different fragments. So these two fragments under syn addition will form this compound. Okay, so based upon this you can identify the structure of the molecule. Next one, fragmentation in alkynes. Alkynes typically show a molecular of propargyl cation. Again you can see MBZ is your 67, and again you know what is 68, it is M plus 1. Already I said you carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen shows M plus 1 peaks. So again 39 because of your propargyl cation. Next one, alcohols. So whenever a molecule contains alcohol, always you need to check for M minus 18, that is loss of water molecule. So another common pattern is loss of alkyl group from the carbon to which alcohol is attached. So suppose if you see in this carbon, so OH is attached. So bulkier alkyl group attached to this will be removed. Okay, this is the fundamental information you need to know, and to form a resonance stabilized oxonium ion. So this is a fundamental information. Next one, so MS of butanol, if you see molecular weight is 74. Now you subtract 74 and 18, whatever you will get is, so it is almost all 56. So that's why the molecule is, this one is your most stable, and sorry, loss of 18, this will show that it will be alcohol. And in alcohols, I said already, so there is loss of, there is a breakage between carbon and carbon to which an alcohol is attached. So that is, that's why there is breakage to the, between C and rest of the C, that's why this portion is called as your base peak. Okay, so this C3H7 is getting break from this one. So already water is lost first, and again you get a C4H8, and from this C4H8, so C3H7 is lost, so you'll get a simple this one. Okay, next one, aldehydes and ketones. So either in aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acids, esters, in these four types of molecule, the most predominant pattern is alpha cleavage, that is alpha to carbonyl carbon. So either alpha to this carbon will undergo cleavage, or alpha to this carbon will undergo cleavage. Next one is McLaughlin rearrangement. So McLaughlin rearrangement is shown in long chain alcohols, long chain acids, long chain esters, in which there is movement of gamma hydrogen to carbonyl one, and there is a beta cleavage, cleavage of between alpha and beta bond. So to form again what? And stable alcohol. Next one, aldehydes and ketones. Same aldehydes, and this is an example of 2-octanol. So this is carbonyl carbon. Either this alkyl group from towards the right will undergo cleavage, or towards the left will undergo cleavage. Again, McLaughlin rearrangement to form a beta cleavage. Next one, carboxylic acid. Again, same. So if you have a MBZ of 45, definitely you can expect that your molecule may contains carboxylic acid. And again you have a McLaughlin rearrangement which you need to practice on your paper, and again you can see my videos which I have manually explained you about the rearrangement of McLaughlin. Again, this is a pattern of acid, so again you can expect MBZ of 45. So you can see 45, that indicates that it's an acid, and there is a cleavage between alpha cleavage and McLaughlin arrangement because you have a gamma carbon. Esters, again there is an alpha cleavage, and again you will get McLaughlin rearrangement. So aromatic hydrocarbon that has toluene undergo rearrangement to form tropylium cation. So always you will get MBZ of 91 and 92. So 91 is because of tropylium cation and 92 is your MBZ value. So you need to remember. Amines undergo a peculiar pattern of cleavage of beta to amine. So the carbon next to the amine is alpha, and carbon next to this carbon is called as beta. So always the cleavage at beta carbon to form most stable carbocation and an imine. So these are the peculiar patterns and fragmentation pattern. Next, in the next lecture, I will discuss regarding the various types of ionization techniques and various types of detectors. So keep watching my channel, share among your friends who are in needy, and if you have any doubts or if you want any material, you can text me on my email, as well as you can get in touch with my WhatsApp number 9714380. Thank you. Keep watching and improve your analytical techniques. Bye bye.